Hello everyone, welcome to Teaching PATHSHALA. This is the fourth part of GPCR in which we are going to discuss about the cholera toxin. In the last of this video, we are going to deal with some CSIR net question mainly on this topic. If you have not seen the last three part of GPCR, then I will mention the link in the description box as well as in the end of this video. Because if you have not seen that part, it might be difficult for you to understand the whole pathway because till now we have discussed so many things regarding the GPCR. So before moving to the further topic, the basic thing should be clear in your mind. This cholera toxin topic is present in total three different units. The first is the cell signaling, then cell structure and membrane, and it is also there in biochemistry as well. So by completing this single video, we are going to complete this topic from three different units. The list of topic that is displaying in front of you, all these topics has already been covered in my previous lectures. So today we are going to deal with the cholera toxin. So cholera toxin is also used to work in a GPCR receptor manner. So that is why we have taken this cholera toxin in the topic of GPCR. Let's start with some general introduction of cholera. So first of all, the cholera is an infectious disease that used to cause a watery diarrhea. That means it can lead to a dehydration, and if it remain untreated, then it will lead to death. And second thing is that if we talk about the source of this infection, then it may be a contaminated food or contaminated water. And this contamination is mainly full of a bacterium that is called Vibrio cholerae. So any water or food that is contaminated with Vibrio cholerae, that will going to lead in a disease that is called cholera. So if we talk about the Vibrio cholerae, so it is a gram-negative comma-shaped bacterium, and it is mainly found in a brackish or salt water. At a time, it may have one flagella as you can see in the figure, or it may have a multiple flagella depending upon the species of Vibrio. Now let's talk about the cholera toxin. So first of all, the cholera toxin is also known as the choleragen, and it is sometimes abbreviated as CTX or the CT. CT means cholera toxin. So this cholera toxin is regarded as a enterotoxin. That means enterotoxin has the capability to affect the intestinal cell, and it is mainly secreted by a bacterium that is known as a Vibrio cholerae. One interesting fact about this Vibrio cholerae is that the Vibrio cholerae is not responsible for the production of a cholera toxin. If you take a normal Vibrio cholerae strain or Vibrio strain, it is not going to cause a cholera. There is a condition in which it used to cause the cholera, that is when the Vibrio cholerae is going to be infected with a phage, and that phage is going to integrate its sum of genome part into the genome of a Vibrio cholerae. At that time, that integrated genome is going to produce a protein that is called the cholera toxin. So this transfer, that is the from one organism, the genome or the DNA is going to transfer in some other organisms. This transfer is called the horizontal gene transfer. And through horizontal gene transfer, the phage or the virus is going to transfer its genetic material in the Vibrio cholerae. And as a result, that Vibrio cholerae, which is infected with a phage genome, is going to produce a toxin which is known as a cholera toxin. I hope the concept of cholera toxin is now clear to you. Now let's talk about the structure of the cholera toxin. So cholera toxin is an oligomeric, or you can say that multimeric complex made up of 6 protein subunit, that is A subunit, which is having a A1 and A2 part, and 5 B subunit. So from the figure you can see the red portion is designating the A subunit, and the green portion, that is mainly 5 green portion, is designating the B subunit. The enzymatic function or the catalytic function is mainly represented by the A subunit, and the result of cholera is going to be there in the form of a watery diarrhea. And the single copy of a A subunit mainly used to perform a enzymatic property, and 5 copies of B subunit is going to act as a receptor binding, or it is going to act as a receptor. And overall it is represented as a AB5, because A is having a single subunit and B is having a total 5 different subunit. So that is why it is designated as a AB5. Now let's come to the main topic of discussion, that is the mode of action of a cholera toxin. So it is going to include a stimulatory G protein. So it is a condition of a G protein in which it is going to stimulate the overall action. So that is why it is known as a stimulatory G protein. And this diagram I have taken from my previous slide, mainly the introduction of the GPCR. So in this figure you can see that the function of the stimulatory G protein is that it used to activate the enzyme that is known as a adenylate cyclase. And in response to the activation, that adenylate cyclase is going to convert the cell's ATP into a cyclic AMP. So in this way, the stimulatory G protein is going to stimulate the adenylate cyclase, and as a result, there is an abundance of cyclic AMP production inside a cell. So this is the main function of a stimulatory G protein, because it is positively stimulating the overall effect. So in this way, we have seen one phase of G protein, that is the stimulatory G protein. So in our future video, we are also going to deal with the inhibitory G protein. At that time, we are going to see a function and a property of an inhibitory G protein. But today we are mainly going to deal with the function of a stimulatory G protein, that is GS. Now let's see the role of ligand and receptor. So first of all, here that mainly in a cholera toxin, the ligand role is going to be played by a cholera toxin. So cholera toxin is going to act as a ligand, and for that ligand there is a receptor which is also known as a ganglionocytes, and the target cell on which this ligand will be present, it is a intestinal epithelial cell. So this ganglionocytes receptor is mainly going to present on a target cell, that is the intestinal epithelial cells. Now the question is that what is ganglionocytes, because here the receptor role is going to be played by a ganglionocytes. So the ganglionocytes is a molecules composed of a glycosphingolipid with one or more sialic acid linked on a sugar chain. So in normal way we can say that the ganglionocytes is a composition of both lipid and sugar. And if we talk about the common type of ganglionocytes, it may be a GM1, GM2 and GM3. So in this portion, that is mainly the mode of cholera toxin, you are going to see the role of a GM1. So GM1 is a type of a ganglionocytes which is going to act as a receptor for the cholera toxin. And this thing is very important. So it should be in your mind that in case of a cholera toxin, the GM1 ganglionocytes is going to act as a receptor. There is an enzyme which is known as a galactosidase, and the function of this galactosidase enzyme is that it used to break the GM1 ganglionocytes. And along with that, the GM1 act as a site of binding for both cholera toxin as well as the E. coli heat labile enterotoxin, which is responsible for causing the traveler's diarrhea. Now there is a new term, that is ADP ribosylation. And why we are studying this? Because this process we are going to see when we will study about the pathway or the mode of action of a cholera toxin. So at that time you will see a particular process, that is the ADP ribosylation. So before that, let's see what is ADP ribosylation, and then we will switch to the pathway. So ADP ribosylation is the addition of one or more ADP ribose moiety to a protein. So it is a process in which there is an addition of a ADP ribose, and that process will include the binding of this ADP ribose on a particular protein, and this whole process will be known as a ADP ribosylation. So in the figure you can see the structure of a ADP ribose, that the ADP is going to bind with a ribose sugar, and overall structure will going to give you a ADP ribose. So this ADP ribose molecule when sit on a protein, and that will lead to the functioning or the process that is called the ADP ribosylation. And if we talk about the function of this ADP ribosylation, that it will include the post-translational modification, and it is also involved in a cellular processes like the cell signaling, DNA repair, gene regulation and apoptosis. Now let's talk about the mode of action of cholera toxin. So this is the whole pathway that will include the overall functioning of a cholera toxin. So first of all, the cholera toxin is having a two subunit, A subunit and B subunit, whereas A subunit is already having a small parts, or you can say that a small domain, that is the A1 domain and A2 domain, and this A1 and A2 domain together going to make a subunit. Okay, but the main function that is going to be performed in this pathway is by A1 domain. So first of all, the B subunit is having the affinity to bind to a GM1 ganglionocytes receptor. When cholera toxin is released from a bacteria in the infected intestine, at that time it binds to an intestinal cell known as an enterocyte or the epithelial cell of intestine, and this binding will be going to take place through a pentameric B subunit of a toxin, and this pentameric B subunit is going to bind with a GM1 ganglionocytes receptor that is present on an intestinal cell. After that, the endocytosis of toxin will take place. Now the thing is that in a endocytosis form, the overall toxin is having a both A subunit and B subunit, but for the action, the A1 domain should become detached, or it should be cleaved from the overall toxin structure. So in this way, it should be needed that A1 domain should be separated from rest of the cholera toxin structure, that is the A and the B subunit. So for this process, the overall toxin is going to transport in a retrograde manner to the endoplasmic reticulum. The retrograde transport means it is going to transport from Golgi apparatus to the endoplasmic reticulum, and this type of transport is known as a retrograde transport. Now the cholera toxin is going to bind with endoplasmic reticulum, and at this point the A1 domain of our overall toxin is going to become detached from the overall structure, and it is going to transport from a particular channel, and it will enter the cytosol of our enterocytes. After entering into the cytosol, this A1 domain or the A1 fragment is having an enzymatic property, and this A1 fragment has been mainly generated from the A subunit of a toxin. Now this A1 fragment has the ability to bind with the G protein, and after binding it is going to activate the GS alpha form, that is the G stimulatory alpha form, because in the previous video also we have seen that the G alpha form is the actual active property or the actual active state of a G protein that is going to do a further action. So here also the G alpha is activated, but here we are mainly talking about the G stimulatory alpha. So this G stimulatory alpha subunit of a G protein is going to be activated by ADP ribosylation reaction. And this ADP ribosylation reaction is mainly going to perform by a A1 fragment of a cholera toxin. Now the main thing is that this ADP ribosylation is going to result in the locking of a G protein in its GTP bound form. And in the previous video, we have seen that the GTP bound form is the active form. So in this form, it is going to perform the positive function. So if a G protein remains in a GTP bound form, it is going to stimulate the overall signaling pathway in a very high amount. And this ADP ribosylation is going to lock the G protein in its GTP form. So that is going to result in a high production of a cyclic AMP through the involvement of an adenylate cyclase enzyme. In other words, we can say that this ADP ribosylation is inhibiting the GTPase activity of a G protein. And this GTPase activity was responsible for the conversion between the GTP to GTP and GTP to GDP. But as because this activity, that is the GTPase activity, is going to be inhibited by the process of ADP ribosylation, that is why there will be the no activity of a GTPase enzyme. And as a result, the G protein will remain bound to the GTP, and this will result in the hyperstimulation of a overall signaling. Now let's come to the pathway again. So after the activation of a G protein, that G protein will going to activate the adenylate cyclase, and the function of the adenylate cyclase is that it used to convert the cell's ATP into a cyclic AMP, and this process we have already seen in a cyclic AMP pathway. So the overall process is same from this point. And next step is that after the production of a high amount of a ATP, that high amount of a cyclic AMP, that cyclic AMP is going to activate the protein kinase A. The protein kinase A is having a high affinity for the cyclic AMP, and the cyclic AMP is responsible to activate the protein kinase A in very high amount, because cyclic AMP is also present in a very high amount inside a cell. So that is why there will be the high amount of activation of a protein kinase A. And we are already knowing that protein kinase A has the ability to phosphorylate any compound that is come in contact with that, because it is a kinase protein. So its nature is to add phosphate on a different molecule. So in this way, the protein kinase A is going to phosphorylate the CFTR. The full form of CFTR is the cystic fibrosis transmembrane conductance regulator. So the high level of a CAMP will result in the hyperactivation of a protein kinase A, and the protein kinase A activation will lead to the hyperphosphorylation of the CFTR, which is going to cause a dramatic efflux of iron and water from the infected enterocytes or the intestinal cell, and this will lead to the watery diarrhea. So as a result of a hyperphosphorylation of a CFTR, there will be the opening of a different ion channel, like chlorine channel, water channel, potassium channel, and the bicarbonate ion channel. So that is going to result in the loss of ions and the nutrient from the body, as well as the water from the body, and that will result in a condition of a dehydration that is going to lead to a watery diarrhea. Now let's revise the whole process. So first of all, the A subunit is having a two fragment, that is A1 fragment and A2 fragment. So initially, when cholera toxin is come in contact with the infected intestinal cell, the B subunit is going to bind with a GM1 receptor, that is the GM1 gangliosides receptor. So after binding, it will be endocytosis inside a cell, and that endocytosis will result in a retrograde transport to the ER membrane. And after coming in contact with the ER membrane, the A1 fragment of A subunit will become cleaved from the overall cholera toxin structure. And that A1 toxin is now going to enter inside a cytosol of a enterocytes. After entering into the cytosol, it is going to bind with a G protein, and it is going to do a ADP ribosylation of that G protein. And this ADP ribosylation is going to inhibit the GTPase activity of a G alpha stimulatory protein. And as a result, this G protein or the G alpha stimulatory protein remain bound to the GTP, which is an active state of a G protein. So in its active state, it is going to activate the adenylate cyclase enzyme. And as a result, the adenylate cyclase enzyme is going to convert the cell's ATP into a high amount of a cyclic AMP. as because there is a high amount of cyclic AMP present. So this cyclic AMP is a target of protein kinase A, and after interacting with the protein kinase A, the protein kinase A will become activated because it is having a high affinity for the cyclic AMP. Now this high amount of protein kinase A activation will lead to the hyperphosphorylation, that means a phosphorylation in a very high amount on a CFTR. And after the hyperphosphorylation of a CFTR, then it will result in the opening of a different ion channel like chlorine, water, calcium, potassium and bicarbonate, and that will result in the loss of nutrient and water from the body, and it will finally result in a watery diarrhea that is also known as a cholera. So for prevention or for cure of the cholera, there should be something in the intestinal cell that is going to inhibit this ADP ribosylation property, and after that the GTPase activity of G protein will be gained and this hyperstimulation of overall pathway will be halt. So in this way the control on cholera will be done, but normally in a disease form it is going to follow all these pathways. I hope the concept of cholera toxin, that how the cholera toxin is related to the GPCR, is now clear to you all. I have tried my best to explain this pathway in as simple way as I can. This is the step for the mode of action of a cholera, which we have already discussed with the help of a diagram. If you are interested in reading all this point, you can pause the video and you can go through this. The next topic is the gangliosidosis. So it is a disease condition that has been related to the gangliosides, and as because we have read about the gangliosides in this lecture only, so that is why I have kept this portion in this part. So let's talk about it. So first of all, the gangliosides are continuously synthesized as well as degraded in a cell, and this degradation will lead to the production of a ceramide by the removal of a sugar unit in a oligosaccharide group. And this overall reaction, that is the degradation, is mainly done by a highly specific enzymes which is also known as a lysosomal enzymes. So one thing has been clear from here, that the lysosome is also involved in the degradation of gangliosides, because the lysosomal enzymes mainly used to produce inside a lysosome. So indirectly the lysosome is also involved in the breakdown of gangliosides. Second thing is that whenever there is a mutation in the gene which used to encode this lysosomal enzyme, at that time there will be the accumulation of a partially broken gangliosides in a lysosomes. As because the mutation condition will lead to the no enzymatic production, that is the lysosomal enzymes production, or there is a partial production of a lysosomal enzyme, at that time there will be the low breakdown of a gangliosides, or you can say that the none of the gangliosides will be break here, and that will result in a disease that is called the gangliosidosis. So in one line we can say that due to the mutation or due to the absence of a lysosomal enzyme, there will be the absence of degradation process of gangliosides, and that is going to result in a disease which is called gangliosidosis. Let's take one example of disease. So the fatal disease, which is known as a Tay-Sachs disease, arises as a genetic defect which lead to the no functional hexosaminidase A produced, and this will cause the GM2, which is a type of a gangliosides, to accumulate in a lysosome. So here also there is an absence of breakdown of GM2, which is a type of gangliosides, and that is why it is also resulting in a condition in which the ganglion cells in a nervous system swells enormously and disturb the normal functioning of a neuron. So here that the enzyme that is involved in this overall process is the hexosaminidase A, and this enzyme is responsible behind the breakdown of a GM2 gangliosides. But as because in Tay-Sachs disease, this hexosaminidase A is not functional, or it is mutated, or you can say that it is inactive. That is why there is an absence of GM2 breakdown, and that is leading to a disease that is called the Tay-Sachs disease, which used to affect the normal functioning of a neuron. Gangliosides are involved in many different diseases like influenza, cholera, tetanus, botulism, leprosy and obesity. Now let's see one question from June 2017. So when the cholera toxin gain access to the human intestinal tract, it bind tightly to a specific receptor in the plasma membrane of epithelial cell lining the small intestine, and causing membrane bound adenyl cyclase to undergo prolonged activation, resulting in excessive loss of water and sodium ion. Pre-treatment of epithelial cells with various phospholipases and proteases failed to inhibit the binding of cholera toxin to its receptor and the fluid loss, but treatment with the exoglycosidase prior to binding significantly reduced this effect. Which of the following molecules could be the receptor for this toxin? So they have described all the important points that was related to the cholera toxin mode of action. So I'm not going to go in that detail. But the main thing that has been started, that is the pre-treatment of epithelial cells with various phospholipases and proteases fails to inhibit the binding of cholera toxin to its receptor and the fluid loss. So first of all, the receptor that was acting in a cholera toxin is the gangliocytes. Okay, so it is not a protein that it could be affected by a protease treatment or the phospholipase treatment, because its nature is the gangliocytes. It is made up of a lipid and carbohydrate or sugar both. So the enzymatic reaction are very specific. It is not like that you can break any substrate with any other enzyme. The specificity between the substrate and enzyme is very important. So in question, they have told that firstly, they have treated the epithelial cell with phospholipase and the protease, but that time also they couldn't be successful in inhibiting the action of a cholera toxin and the loss of fluid was totally continuous. But after the treatment of a exoglycosidase enzyme, there was a reduce in the effect or the reduction in the effect of a water loss. So what is the reason and which molecule is acting as a receptor for this toxin? Okay, so in second case, when they have treated with the exoglycosidase enzyme, at that time, that enzyme has removed the gangliocytes because this enzyme is specific for breakdown of a gangliocytes. And as because there is a no receptor for the toxin, so obviously how the toxin is going to bind to epithelial cell, so automatically there will be the no effect of a cholera toxin and the cell will remain in a normal condition. That means there will be the no loss of a water from overall epithelial cell. Because the interaction of ligand and receptor is very specific. So if a particular ligand is coming, there should be a receptor to receive that ligand so that the signal transduction will be carried on. But here, as because with the help of a exoglycosidase enzyme, the gangliocytes is affected, that is degraded. That is why there is no receptor for receiving the ligand, that is a cholera toxin. So how the overall action will be going to take place? So there will be the absence of a particular process that will lead to a cholera. So now we have to pick that which toxin was acting as a receptor in the above process. So now it is very easy to pick the correct option. So the first option is phosphatidylcholine. So it is a wrong answer because there is no involvement of phosphatidylcholine. Second is the sodium potassium ATPase. This is also wrong answer. Third is the gangliocytes. So gangliocytes is going to act as a receptor for the cholera toxin. And fourth is the chloride bicarbonate exchanger. This is also a wrong answer. So the correct answer is the gangliocytes. That is the option 3. I don't know whether you have noticed or not, but they have asked this question very smartly. Because initially they have mentioned that there is an action of a cholera toxin. And the students who are knowing the whole mode of action of a cholera toxin, they don't have to think a lot about this question because the receptor for the cholera toxin is always a gangliocytes. Okay, so this is a question that has been made from simple to complex just to confuse a student. But if you are clear in your concept, you can answer this question very easily. Now let's move to the second question, that is again from 2017 June. So the question is, in Tay-Sachs disease, accumulation of a glycolipid occurs especially in a nerve cells. These cells are greatly enlarged with swollen lipid-filled endosomes, and the children with this disease die at a very early age. Such condition occur due to the specific defect in. So you have to pick a correct statement that through which defect this Tay-Sachs disease mainly used to cause. So in the slide of gangliocytosis, we have studied about this disease. So I'm not going to describe it again. Let's jump to the options. So first option is the specific lysosomal enzyme that catalyzes a step in the breakdown of a gangliocytes. So they have asked about the defective condition that is leading to a Tay-Sachs disease. So the first option is the correct option because there was a defect in a lysosomal enzyme that used to catalyze the breakdown of a gangliocytes. And due to the absence of the breakdown of gangliocyte, the condition that used to result is the Tay-Sachs disease. And the second option is the shorting of an enzyme that adds a phosphate group at 6th position of a mannose in all acidic hydrolysis. This option is wrong because I think it is related to a lysosomal protein synthesis or something like this. Third question is one of the RAP protein involved in recycling of a vesicles. So this option is also wrong. In fourth option, they have mentioned about the V-snare action. So there is no relation regarding the V-snare with a Tay-Sachs disease. So in this way, the correct option is the option 1. This question was also very easy and it is a direct question because they have not just complicated this question with any different information. Because if you are knowing about the Tay-Sachs disease, you can easily able to pick a correct answer. If you are new to my channel, you can subscribe my channel for getting more different videos on CSIR NET and different life science examination. Along with that, don't forget to hit the bell icon just beside of the subscribe button so that you will be notified with my each and every new video.